Alistar probably up there as well as far as at least popular picks goes, but we'll get into Champ Select now. M3 over on the blue side for the first game, King over on the red, and players just get into the lobby. I'm curious to see where the teams want to go with their bans. And Sivir, is she worth a ban?
I guess we'll have to find out. There's been a lot of disagreement on what the pick ban strategy is between teams. Some teams 4-5 mid lane bans, some teams 4-5 jungle bans. There's not necessarily been any rhyme or rhythm. It hasn't just been Kakao's on the enemy team, ban out 3 junglers. I guess there's just a lot of debate over what's strong, and I think that starts to favor the purple side, just because then again, you get the last pick, counter pick for mid, potentially, or top lane. Hell, AD carries sometimes, it seems. But also you get, in the first round, 2 picks, and it doesn't feel like there's one priority pick that's the god tier first pick champion, like Kassadin was, perhaps, towards the start of the LPL spring. There's lots of strong champions, and in the third, fourth rotations, you're still piling on those priority picks.
Yep, so we are way through most of the bans now. We can see Gragas and Kalista being banned away from Huey and Nami, respectively. Azir and Rek'Sai are going to join in again. 4 strong champions here. And I think it's funny that you mentioned both jungle and mid. It seems to be a split as far as the top champions go. Most teams like to cut off maybe the top 2 for each role, but that does open up quite a few picks like that Sivir that we've mentioned.
But the Kalista is the only AD carry so far targeted. Yesterday, M3 actually first picked Kalista on the blue side, and it didn't lead to a victory in that game. It was the Lucian from SMLZ on the purple side that was by far the more successful. Alistar actually banned through the Alistar priority. It sometimes works out, but I just don't see it.
Well, that is going to give Looper Hecarim, which is not usually something we want to be saying, but Sejuani banned up there as well, going to narrow the jungle pool just a bit. That's actually 3 junglers banned away, so Huey, big Rek'Sai player, Sejuani, Gragas, not far behind, if behind at all as far as jungle priority goes. I'd say that's 3 good junglers all gone, so what's the next one? It might have to be Nunu.
Yeah, the only one left in terms of the top tier junglers is the Nunu, but the one thing you can say about Nunu is although he has this very oppressive playstyle, definitely in the face of other junglers, not the best lane ganker. So they've engineered a situation where they're not forced into first picking Kalista, they're not giving away Kalista in the first rotation, and the only high priority jungle pick is one that doesn't have a lot of lane ganking synergy. Now it actually frees up Hecarim to potentially find a bit of time, leave lane, farm up. It's a situation where if they gave away Rek'Sai, suddenly Hecarim always going to be under risk when you go teleport smite. Against a Nunu, maybe you can get away with it.
I mean, I like the lane matchup, so not Nunu, the picks there for King are interesting, but with the smite especially, Looper probably going to have plenty of free time. King, I can see their theory, but in practice, it's going to be interesting. I also like that they're sort of baiting them into a Sivir pick as well, because Nunu Jinx, of course, was EDG's big thing last season, but we'll see where Kondi goes especially. Haven't seen him at anything other than Rek'Sai Lee Sin, I believe, so might just have to go back to Lee Sin.
I mean, this game's crying out for an Evelynn, I think. That's probably the most optimal pick. It's what Clearlove showed in the MSI final, that the Evelynn versus Nunu matchup. Again, you can't keep so easy tabs on an Evelynn, even if you pick up the Sight Stone. You can ward the camps, but it only does so much in that situation. Not confident on the Evelynn, I'd have to think, I do not want to see Cinderhulk Lee Sin again. I think if you're going to go Lee Sin, make up for the fact that you've got this farming top laner who wants to pick up Cinderhulk into tanky items, potentially even into a Trinity Force. Go for the warrior, be a god of the mid game, and let the Hecarim do the heavy lifting in the late game.
Well, is Lee Sin threshed there? So some early aggression and playmaking available. King, considering the next few champions, I already mentioned Nunu Jinx, that would make the most sense to me. Nami, really good Jinx player, and this would semi-block the Sivir pick as well. Khorne even going to stay true to his assassins with LeBlanc and King. These are strong picks for them.
It's very Edward Gaming-esque so far in the 4 champions they've picked up. They've got a very strong mid laner, a winning top lane matchup as well. Both these champions are likely to have wave control, so that'll open up Nunu. Just walk into the enemy jungle. Unless there's some very smart reactions from the Master 3 duo, it's going to be super, super difficult for them to actually stop this Nunu from just ruining Evelynn's life. Evelynn, a very fast jungle farmer, especially in the early game, but will eventually get warned and has very low base stats, so can be counter jungled by the master of the counter jungle, Nunu. Still plenty of powerful picks, but I'm impressed with the 4 champions that King have managed to assemble so far.
Yeah, they've got a decent last pick as well. Not that much flexibility actually last picking support, but just taking priority and trying to cut off M3's options. It will be Sivir there for SMLZ, but we've already explained the matchup. Not great against the Jinx in the lane, and Dade's going to do it again. Pick the counter matchup into the LeBlanc once more with his Vladimir.
And look, he pulled off a massive outplay during the course of yesterday's games and managed to dominate that matchup. Wasn't expected. Ghost Flash and scaling runes and still able to be one of the strongest early game champions in LeBlanc. He's going to try it again, but if it fails, I feel like that will really just move on to the rest of his lineup, he's going to really, really struggle in this particular matchup. The late game's looking excellent for Master. You've got that synergy between Sivir Hecarim. You've got Vladimir in the late game, who gets super, super strong, and Dade, who takes those selfish runes, ruined around the late game. This sort of a comp did overcome the lineup yesterday for Master 3, but if King played perfectly in the early game, there is that potential to snowball it away. Pun intended, with Nunu from Master 3.
Always, with the last pick Morgana there, help protect that Jinx. Looked at the Janna, thought that, you know what, Hecarim's ult, kind of hard to stop with CC, so just Black Shield to make sure Name's safe there.
It's going to be difficult to keep the Black Shield up in the late game if they can, if they can't keep Dade away. He's got double escape summoners, and he's got the Sivir ultimate, so he's the one most likely to just, in the course of all his AoE magic damage, just have enough to burst through the Black Shield. But it's a very balanced lineup, early game versus late game. It's an exciting one because both teams have their win conditions. They're very clear. They're sin in the draft. So how does that affect the lane? So how does that affect the early game? Because if this King lineup doesn't really organize their early game effectively, they will get outscaled by Master 3.
Well, we are going to go through the lineups now. Hecarim versus Gnar on the top side. Kola, happy with the matchup, but Looper deadly on that horse.
Exactly. He's a very practiced Hecarim player. Lee Sin versus Nunu. That's the big question to me. Kondi on Lee Sin. Can he make it work? Because yesterday it didn't look, it was found wanting in a lot of ways.
Well, Dada could make his matchup work there against the LeBlanc, but Name back in the lineup, back on Jinx as well. This is how he started his debut in the last season. We'll see if he can get it done again against Sivir. His Love City is back on his thresh, and Sync Dream a little less aggressive there, but still solid support in Morgana.
And it's the Jinx versus Sivir matchup that we talked and mused about in the last couple of days, but never actually saw happen in lane. It should favor Jinx, especially after the first couple of levels. But Name, he's a master of Jinx. Can he make it work?
We'll have to find out. Let's get straight onto the Rift. And welcome into our first game of the day here, day three, King versus Master 3 for our opening best of two. Of course, we're going to start with game one, so neither team with a point just yet, but King going to try and look for a win. Yesterday, didn't get any against Egua Gaming in M3. Want to see if they can make it a bit better than 1-1.
King have a very strong level one lineup. Actually, quite a poor ward from SMLZ. Does spot out the five members, but wasn't actually in the brush. They'll keep on their invade. Five members put forward, and the answering walls look to come down from Looper.
Yep, good counter rotation there from Looper. Going to get some vision down. Lanswap might be the name of the game here for M3, actually, with Looper putting a nice spotting ward there in the top side of the map. Love CD also getting some vision down on his own Krug. So good vision here for M3, just spotting King moving through their jungle.
King haven't got the deep wards that would really incentivize the lane swap that they might be looking for. They haven't committed either way. With Gnar walking towards the top side, looks like they're looking for standard lanes. Sivir and Thresh holding back, just not wanting to reveal. They know there's no lane wars that spot them just yet, so they're leaving it flexible, and we'll wait to see what exactly they decide is the optimal path.
Yeah, didn't see any pings there onto Kola, but he does make his way into the top side, so Ward might have just been out of vision. He hugged that wall pretty tightly, but Huey going to start on the Grump, get a bit of help here from Name and Sync Dream, and as we can see right now from the positioning, it looks like standard lanes.
Yeah, standard lanes. We think it will favor King. We've seen a lot of this Jinx versus Sivir matchup. I feel like in the early couple levels and at level 6, there's some outplay potential coming through from the Sivir lane. Just get in the face of Jinx, using the fact that she doesn't have a natural scape against her and try and burst her down. So in terms of burst trades, Sivir has an option, but in terms of those long poke trades, Jinx will always win with her extra range and rocket launcher form.
And you can see Kola actually doing a camp for himself, so pretty creative stuff there. Down the bottom though, already having some poke being traded as they're going to trade blows back and forth. Looper got the Grump though, he's going to move back to the lane, and Sick Dream getting aggressive. Love CD doesn't really want to be standing there. Early level 2, very well played by King. Name going to go in, and that's first blood to Sick Dream as SMLZ going to get chased down as well, but that Grump, they did get it. Very smart all in.
I feel like Master 3 had to have the information to know that they entered lane late, they were low health, they must have known that it was inevitable that there would be a level 2 being pinged, but it's completely disrespected by Love CD. Gives away an early first blood, crucially doesn't go over to Name, but still a big boon for the Jinx lane and what was always going to be a tough matchup for Sivir.
Yeah, one of the places where Sivir can start to get control is the early stages of the lane with the Ricochet, with just some flat AD. When Jinx goes back, gets her first big item, usually a BF sword, then the struggles come, but that struggle is going to come much sooner here.
Absolutely, and then Morgana's definitely feeling happy. Might even be able to go into the luxury upgrade of the GP10 item, because every time you put down that puddle, 30 gold instantly if you have the stacks available. probably just going to be a quick sidestone. But, you know, you can dream, and Sync Dream does love to go for those more greedy choices.
He does indeed. I mean, maybe Azonius is thinking already, I can go the snowball at him and really get some initiations going. But Love CD will return a bit sheepishly to lane here, and Nami already getting ahead. Good chompers actually to Zonu Mountain. Just some poke with the rockets as well.
People just disregard the fact that a lane like Jinx and Morgana, you throw down those chompers, if they aren't, we're talking about 2.5 seconds plus of CC, what, at level 2? It's insane. And then you swap to the machine gun form. So much early damage, and Love CD found out just exactly what happens in those situations.
I think it was World Elite's dual lane that were doing it last season with Jinx and Thresh, which is even more level 2 CC with the flay and the hook. And, you know, Sync Dream just with the binding there, maybe not quite as brutal as Thresh, but Love CD found out that it's more than enough CC to kill him.
So we'll see how this lane goes in this situation. I have to think that if SMLZ is on the back foot at level 2, the same is going to be true level 3 through level 6. There never may be that all-in potential just because the first item timings will be that much better for King. And King should just really abuse this bottom lane matchup. We already mentioned the fact that they were probably going to win bottom lane. Korn is having a better time against Dade than Xiaohu did yesterday. Nah will naturally win this top lane matchup, although Condi might have something to say about it.
Gonna try and make some pressure happen. Needs to hop away. Does find it. Meganafon on the way, but not quite there. Kola gets dove in, and Condi, beautiful Q, picks himself up a kill.
Super smart to hold on to the Q till after the devastating charge caused a little mini stun at the end of the CC. Q comes out, first one comes down, the Looper fans seem very happy in the crowd.
They should. I mean, Looper getting some gold for himself there with the assist. Hecarim's a champion that does need to get his gold to get going, so any help is useful there in the lane. Is Huey setting off a nice early dragon here on Nunu.
A point in all abilities, not quite the 2 points in consumes, will take slightly bit longer taking that dragon. Dade, this is what happens when you take those scaling runes. Nothing's changed for Dade. The Korn really abusing him more than Xiaohu was able to.
Got a decent CS lead, starting to play aggressive as well. And Sync Dream's now going to rotate over. Nami will come in as well. Kisui's like, yeah, couldn't really finish it on my own at level 3.
We didn't actually notice, but Dade did go for a more conservative item choice. He started with the Doran Shield. Makes a lot of sense. You're going to take those auto attacks from LeBlanc, but importantly, single target spells like the Q, for example, 8 less damage adds up over the course of what's going to be a very trying lane for Dade.
I mean, his starter boots yesterday might just be a respect thing here coming through for the laners, but Korn starting off on the better foot and Dade starting more defensively, so his counterpick from yesterday not quite working out just yet, but Vladimir, as always, will scale just brilliantly as the lane continues.
I don't know about the use of the word counterpick in this particular situation. It's definitely his pick against LeBlanc. It's an optimistic one. He made it work once, and if he does it again, that might just be a Dade special. He was confident picking Yasuo and Zed into matchups that on paper looked terrible for those AD assassins. And if he can do the same things with Vladimir, who's much more in vogue than the two aforementioned champions, that's another boon for Dade.
It is indeed. Here is Korn returns to lane, getting a Fiends actually on the way, it looks like, with the Chalice starting things off. We noted this yesterday. No Morelli Nomicon sort of hurt Xiaohu in his lane yesterday against Dade's Vlad, but I like the choice here from Korn, just a bit more conservative.
I mean, I can understand where you're coming from, but you just build so well if you're going for the Merlin Omicron, 600 gold for the Forbidden Idol, 820 for the Fiendish Codex, and it works so well against Dade. You might think magic resist is necessary, but you don't build a Fiends for magic resist. Only 25 magic resist coming through from that item. So going this more defensive choice, there's no other magic damage on the side of Master 3. Just get Merc Treads in this situation. You can just go for the more offensive snowball option and really cut down on the healing that Dade will be putting out, especially in the late game.
I mean, to me, that just says that Korn might not feel confident, maybe with the jungle pressure not really being there, actually killing Dade, because one thing that Chalice does give you is more sustain and just more options as far as wave clear goes, which is why most LeBlanc started shifting away from Morelli Nomicon, especially after the changes.
No, it's definitely a flexible option. Someone like Faker is definitely more a proponent of going for the Morelli Nomicon. If you're on the back foot, that's fine. Huey, though.
Yeah, getting caught here by Condi. Gonna follow through. Beautifully timed spells. Ult there from Looper as well. They're trying to gift the kill away, but Condi will claim his second.
Master 3 with their strong lanes have actually been smart enough here. No, understanding that Looper is in a good position in top after the gank. The fact that Vlad was doing just fine. Whenever you go for those solo invade missions, you always get threat of collapse, and the collapse was really strong for Master 3.
Yeah, news not too bad here. Mid lane's going okay, Dade falling behind, but staying in it for now as he picks up levels. Revolver now as well with the Doran Shield to help him out. In fact, Condi might even look for a gank as well.
He's just trying to look for the distortion to be used. Specifically, he knows the Mimic is down already. That would have been communicated from Dade. Distortion used.
Yeah, Hemo Plague there as well. Good pull coming in. Condi gonna have to kick Korn away. Good Q landing. Massive Q lands in, and Dade gets the kill. brilliant gank from Condi.
We praised his Lee Sin mechanics on form data. Looked like he might have overstayed super, super low, but not in room and not in space of any of those abilities. Super Mega Death Rocket almost flashed into by Dade.
I think Name was mind gaming Dade there, but does not eat the rocket. Name's ult will miss. That would have killed him for certain with the execute damage coming through. But unfortunately for King, the only lane that's now going well is the bottom lane.
I don't know what to say about that particular flash, but he's still alive, so worth, I guess, can be typed in all chat after that one. In the bottom lane, they now know that the Super Mega Death Rocket is down. So honestly, even after all the early situation where the gold has been passed over to Name, if Name and Sync Dream had stayed in lane, there was that all-in potential, knowing that the execution damage from the rocket isn't going to be up for about another 90 seconds.
Yeah, going to go back though. BF Sword now for Name and a dagger, so probably looking for some early Berserker grief. Saw a lot of this from him when he came back in the Spring Split. Khorne will get the blue buff now as well. And again, King, a lot riding on this bottom lane now, because they're already 1,000 gold behind.
It might not seem like a crucial factor, but just seeing that rocket being down actually allowed SMLZ and LoveCity to get the first back. There hadn't been any shopping between the two, even with the first blood coming so much earlier in the game. So they managed to push in the turret, get back, get to back, and come back to lane without the lane being in a bad spot. That's more than you would have expected after a very fast first buy at level 2.
Comes back with more items as well, actually. Avarice Blade there for SMLZ. Going to be in a relatively comfortable landing phase from here on out. It's not happy, I guess, in the matchup, but if he can keep competitive, which he already has been, although Name and Sync Dream will return to the bottom side now, they keep the matchup here. Don't lose too many CS, and all of a sudden they'll look just fine when that first next big dragon fight rolls around.
Well, staying competitive after the worst happens and you lose a kill in the first couple of minutes, again, is more than expected. So SMLZ will take it. He's picked for comp. Sivir Hecarim in the late game. Sivir Hecarim Vladimir even is just such a potent combo that's been on the winning side much, much more than it has on the losing. More babysitting from Condi in the mid lane.
Yeah, I mean, this is the lane he sort of has to pay attention to. Dade not able to get ahead somehow like he did yesterday against Xiaohu in the same matchup. So keeping up in CS is nice. He's actually going to go back now, get himself a Negatron Cloak. So setting himself up, probably going to go for the Abyssal again. Will the Ancients mixed in there somewhere as well, but just trying to stay alive against this LeBlanc.
And this is a much more predictable strategy from M3 to King. It's very scoutable. You're going to expect the strong ganking jungler to pay attention to the mid lane that was a bit of a self-counterpick, but Dade's making it work again. He's got the scaling runes. He's got the help from the jungler this game. Doesn't need the crazy outplay he managed against Xiaohu. But with that help, he snowboarded into equal CS and, of course, the kill credit after picking up the kill onto Khorne. So another successful Vladimir versus LeBlanc laning matchup, at least in the first 11 minutes for Master 3.
I mean, M3 potentially, you could say, picked three losing lanes here, and Condi's just bridged them all wonderfully. Hecarim's not that great against Nas. Sivir's certainly not great against Jinx, and Vlad, he said it, the self-counter pick for Dade there in the mid lane. The fact that they're all even in CS is a big credit to that jungle, who's sitting very happily at 100% kill participation.
Sitting on a Cinderhulk. That is still the choice from Lee Sin. I'm still remain to be convinced. I think it pigeonholes him into only late game peel mode. There isn't even that modicum of damage that you can put out with the warrior enchant, specifically armor penetration for your very high base AD. You have a 3.6 AD ratio. Don't often fit a lot of AD into your build, but that one slot effective warrior enchant made a lot of sense to me, at least. Condi played a lot of Lee Sin, just going to be more of a peel bot in the late game.
Yeah, I mean, Lee Sin, again, we haven't seen that much of him as Condi does find Sync Dream Name as well. The Binding will land in, but the Lantern should keep him safe. Hook actually landing in, but Chompers will keep them safe. And six people down in the bottom side, but no one's dead yet.
Had to respect the Chompers. Looking at Cola's build, double Ruby Crystal. I've talked about the build a few times, the fact that it builds so well into Black Cleaver. Would love to see that being the choice, to just keep tabs on Looper. But being behind in lane, it's always a risk to build a laning item when you're behind in lane, because that means that team fights not even really an option. And there's always that potential that lane snowballs even further while you're trying to build the expensive Black Cleaver.
Yeah, and Cola, you know, does have some options. You mentioned yesterday that Black Cleaver, one of the nice things about the new item is that you can just build it out of almost anything with those two Ruby Crystals. But we'll see where Cola wants to go. His next shop's actually now. In the first part, at least, it's a Giant's Belt.
So Giant's Belt, another one of the options with the Ruby Crystal. So probably going to be more defensive. Maybe the Frozen Mallet will be the choice. But again, could be Frozen Mallet, could just be Giant's Belt into a Randuin's and then building the Spectre's Cowl. You never know with double Ruby Crystal, and that's why I think increasingly it will become the common first purchases for top lane.
Oh, LoveCity actually in trouble. Damage coming through there for Name. LoveCity has to dodge the ulti there for Jinx. Condi in there as well, but SMLZ now tanking rockets. Good Q lands in for Condi, but doesn't follow through. Finds the ulti somehow, though, and gets the kill onto Thresh.
Seems like poor communication between the bottom lane. Should have been some way to either flash forward or backwards by either Love City or SMLZ respectively to stop the splash range from being enough for a kill. Maybe just miscalculations, but another free kill over to King.
I didn't quite catch it, but I wonder if SMLZ thought that Spellshield would save him there, because I believe it does not in that situation.
I think maybe the splash damage still applies. I'm not 100% clear on that interaction, but the result, a kill over to Name, one kill, one assist, equal in CS. Jinx into the late games, not something we've seen in the LPL so far this split, but we have plenty of tape to show that is a scary proposition.
It is, and it's a Name special up there with Deft as far as strong Jinx players go, but SMLZ still sitting just fine here. Love City again, two deaths there in that column, probably not his most glamorous start to a game, but he'll be just fine here, and that's M3's team here. Get to the mid game, stay farmed up, stay consistent, and your team fighting just takes over the mid and late game.
And the late game, the person who's really going to be looked at to deal with this Jinx is going to be Looper, who has been snowballed by his jungler, has Cinderhulk into what is clearly looking like a Phage at minimum, but the Trinity Force at some point in the laning phase. Dade takes a lot of poke. Khorne has low mana, though.
Ignite down there as well. Actually, Hemo play going to turn it around. Khorne's forced to flash as Kondi with some very nice timing. Keeps LeBlanc at bay. And Dade, once again, baiting it just at the last second with his jungler just in reserve.
You're doing fine. Had the jungle help once again. Huey's shown no paid no attention to mid. To be honest, ganking a Vladimir as Nunu, you can't do anything whenever pull is available. Can pull the slow coming through. Have no other CC really to affect a gank. So Huey not being able to help mid, Kondi's had free reign.
And that's exactly what's happened. Relying on Khorne's matchup worked for the first couple of levels, but Dade, especially now at level 10, going to take things over. Name, though, returns to the bottom side. Pickaxe done as well with that Crit Cloak, and the Berserker Groove's already completed, means that that tower just melted.
Very close to finishing the Infinity Edge. A lot of pressure going to be on Looper. The only person to really be a diver on his team in the late game to deal with a Jinx has been empowered by two early kills in lane. Going to be a fast horse, though, with the Sivir ultimate. Vladimir also going to be a bit of a question mark in that way. Kondi's caught.
Kondi caught there as well in the Chompers. Now Name keeps going in, but Syncdream's ulti gets cancelled. Dade actually gets a kill onto Khorne. Ulti down, though, for Name. Does not find its mark, and Looper joining in with his ultimate gets the kill under tower.
And it's not often that you can spill in from the top lane as a Hecarim in the Hecarim-Nar matchup, actually find time to leave lane and gank and not lose your turret. But because Nar's been on the back foot the whole laning phase thanks to Kondi, the top lane problems spill into the mid. Dade gets snowballed, and every lane barring bot going well for Master 3.
Good sneak in though from Cola. Porter down, going to find SMLZ. Ulti pop there, Flay used there as well. Great hop there from Cola, finds his way on top of Love City. Chompers go down and Cola a well-deserved kill.
There was no turret to get back to. That's why they were confident enough to flash in aggressively, pick up one kill. No way to get into SMLZ, who importantly holds on to his flash, but this might be Dragon.
It is Dragon here for King, it looks like, and it's going to be their second. And we look at the team comps, we see M3 and see just how strong it is in the late game, but an early-ish Dragon for King for the first, reasonably well timed for the second here, although waited a few more minutes in King. The win condition's pretty clear. Get Name up and take that fifth Dragon.
Smart awareness to know that while Cola teleported in with no rage whatsoever on that Gnar bar, you might have thought, okay, this is not going to lead to anything. Because there was no turret to go back to and that it hit the first boomerang, they had enough consistent CC to pick up at least one kill, and they picked up an objective from it, so it's a good trade. The frozen mount's completed. We're going to see the replay in the mid lane. Looper gallops through, picks up the kill.
Yeah, Dade even flashes forward for the transfusion just to ensure the kill. Takes the mid turret as well during the replay. And Dade, now level 11, has taken over another mid lane as Vladimir.
Cola has this frozen mount, making Looper's life held. Importantly, there's no cooldown left on the ultimate.
Syncdream, though, may be caught by Kondi. Good binding from Syncdream. Going to keep himself safe, but Cola in the top side does get the kill onto Looper in Mega Gnar form, and the lanes are swapping back and forth.
Yeah, well, he was actually proxy farming, far too aggressive. The red buff goes down, and now you can't even enter lane if you're Looper against a frozen mallet red buff Gnar. I was worried about building for lane, but it paid off in the biggest way possible.
Yeah, gets the item, immediately returns to lane and get a kill. Probably all he could ask for there from the item as the tower in bot does go down as well there. M3 take it away, so 2-1 now in that objective. But behind in Dragons are Master 3 and still need to scale just a bit more.
I mean, scaling is the name of the game for both teams. Name's at a very good spot in this game. The comp is actually going to become completely Name-focused in the late game, because for Khorne, as an assassin, you look down the roster, it's very difficult to kill anyone. Maybe Lee Sin is your easiest choice, with the Spell Shield often negating enough for the instant 100-0 burst coming through from LeBlanc to potentially kill SMLZ. Love CD also one of the more tastier options, the more consistent damage. In fact, the only true consistent damage is going to be Name. He's got the zone control coming through from Huey. He's got the black shield coming through from Morgana. It'll be hard to space fights, but if Name's free hitting, there's a real chance that King win a late game team fight.
And look, if you describe to me, you know, an immobile AD carry, very positioning focused, needs to play perfectly, that's the games that Name classically won back in 2014. I don't know if he's quite up to the task now in 2015, given that he didn't get to play most of last season, but if anyone can do it, at least traditionally, it is going to be this player.
Yeah, historically, absolutely. In 2015 form, we have to wait and see, and especially with a Hecarim who's free farmed. Okay, he's died once in lane, but will be moving towards a Frozen Heart and probably a Trinity Force at some point. It's one of the best ways to deal in the late game with a Jinx. They're 3 turrets to 2 down, so they're going to be able to start pushing in aggressive wards. If the flank comes onto this Jinx, doesn't matter what your mechanics are like, you will die to this horse.
And Looper is fantastic when it comes to flanks as well. Has great teleport usage. You can look down, not quite with the Homeguard boots just yet, but Skirmisher, Saber, Cinder, Hogtun, Phage, Merc Treads, and a Glacial Shroud mean that he's starting to get going on the Hecarim.
I mean, there's no rush to get the Homeguard boots. We don't see any sort of flank wards put down from. In fact, good defensive vision coming through from King. Surprisingly defensive, actually, from both teams. They haven't really been looking for the aggressive wards. Now that the outer ring of turrets is down, maybe after the next dragon, the winning side will see fit to actually invade for vision. But for now, neutral vision about.
Yeah, you can see another pink ward there, keeping M3's vision on their half of the map. Binding did land, but no kill pressure there. Dade returns to the mid lane. Abyssal Scepter has been completed for a short while. Sork Truth, and now we need to see Large Rod joining into the party with his revolver. Dade also starting to get powered up, and SMLZ, Infinity Edge, Avarice Blade, Berserker Greaves, M3. That time that King seemed to be on in this game is starting to tick forward.
I wondered how he'd actually managed to afford the Needless to Large Rod. In this case, he hasn't gone for the World of the Ancients. I don't know if that's going to prove to be the right decision. There's only a little bit of burst coming through from the King lineups, only coming through from the LeBlanc, so I thought maybe the sustained Belvamp coming through might be the big winner, but it might just be a case of, okay, I'm feeling good in this lane. I don't need the Will of the Ancients for lane. I'll go for the more teamfight options, maybe even a Zhonya's very early, and still be super relevant with the Spellvamp.
You can see those Tides of Blood stacked up there, just melting through the minding waves. Dade firmly sitting himself in this mid lane and challenging people to come and try and kill him. Even still has his tower up there as well, so he is sitting in Dade's happy place.
Abyssal Scepter is actually very necessary in terms of wave clear for Vladimir. Back when it had higher base damage, you didn't need to actually pick up the Abyssal Scepter to hoover down waves. But now the only way that you can reliably instant clear the backline is to pick up the Abyssal Scepter. Of course, the 20 magic resistance debuff works on the lane minions, and as you can see, one Tides of Blood, the whole minion wave, barring a couple of autos onto the melee range minions, dies instantly.
Yeah, Dade, a real nuisance here, actually. Now clearing out some pink wards as well, starting to push vision further and further forward, at least in the mid lane, even as a lane ward there as well. So very well protected is Dade, Name, and Sync Dream just looking for farm around the map, but down the bottom, Cola doing the same, but SMOZ, he's there to match that big stack of minions charging towards him.
And Khorne has taken a leaf from Faker's playbook. Second item Void Staff. In this particular situation where there's going to be a very big stack of magic resistance down onto the Vladimir, it gives some kill pressure onto the Vladimir. Doesn't really help with wave here because, of course, you don't have the AP values to mimic Distort, but it still gives you burst potential. And LeBlanc, her first job, her first role is always burst.
Yeah, I think King realized that they need to win the next big fight that's coming up here at Dragon, so optimize for the team fights. Cola's gotten tankier, although maybe wants a bit more health. Got that one Ruby Crystal there still. Void Staff done. Phantom Dancer on the way. Mikhail's just finished there for Sync Dream. A lot of good tools here for King to fight, but they do need to secure this third dragon.
M3 able crucially to steal away the blue buff. Now SMLZ has it. Wave clear on command is what Sivir gets naturally. That much easier when you can even disregard your mana bar. In terms of control, they haven't quite got the deep wards down to Master 3, but every other way, they're set up to finally pick up their first dragon.
And Cola, unfortunately, just hit Mega now. Might be waiting to teleport in here, but Huey going to get grabbed. Black Shield keeps him safe, though, so smart clearing, but Nah, we'll go back into mini form for this next dragon fight, and a tired Nara is not what you want in this situation.
Looper's not even looking for the home guard initiate. It's gone for the second part of the Trinity Force, which will be completed far, far earlier. Nara needs to wait to pick up any rage. We'll teleport anyway.
He's coming. I think he's still tired. We're going to start building up rage relatively soon. Huey just fancies a 50-50. Doesn't get it. Sivir takes it away, but Dade dives in for a team fight. Huey pops his ulti to zone them away, but Hemoplague does massive damage. Looper diving into the backside, and it's carnage now. as Looper gets a double. Kola tries to run away, but it's going to get taken out by Condi. Name can't do anything with four people chasing him. And four kills, including a triple for Hecarim. M3 completely steamroll that fight.
Super hard for King to reach their win conditions when Khorne is out of position and when the front line dies so fast that it doesn't matter if they have abilities to peel for Jinx if they're dead. Jinx dies last. It's still completely disregarded. And speaking of disregard, they're tanking up this inner turret and they're going to be able to put up so much aggressive vision and with the dragon secured off a critical strike.
Yeah, that's gone there. Is that poor turret. So 4-2 now in turrets. The middle turret still standing there for Dade as Condi going to help clean out some of the waves here as well. Trinity Force is done for Looper, so Name's life got even harder. A death cap done for Dade as well. Let's see this last fight.
So Crit actually steals away the dragon. You can see Huey's trying to zone out and provide, but Name has not got any auto attacks off yet. And finally, the very late onslaught of Shadows comes in. One member dies instantly. Name has no one peeling from him because everyone is super squishy. Kola teleporting in, tired, did so many things that really held down King in that fight. He wasn't able to build up rage, never got into Mega Knights, never had the tank stats, and hasn't built for team fights anyway. He has Frozen Mallet and a Warden's Mail. He wants to extend the laning phase. Looper casually walked to the dragon, was able to push the wave in top, so doesn't even lose a big load of creeps. In fact, SMLZ will go and pick it up now. Kola not able to do his job means that King easily lose a team
fight.
Yeah,
just not on the same page there as far as builds and just positioning goes there as well. We talked about it. King need to snowball these dragons. Huey tried almost desperately to take it away and lost it to a crit there from Sivir. So King going to be set back quite a number of minutes, and time is one thing they cannot afford to give M3.
So then why do they go for a laning focus build on Nah if they understand that team fighting around dragon is their only true win condition? That's kind of the anachronism that's come through, is that Kola contrived a situation where he couldn't even push in a massive stack and force Looper to stay in top. Looper could casually walk to the dragon, teleport through in minion R form without even a teamfight build, and it keeps the snowball, and the global snowball might lead to Baron. They've been spotted out, but they want to do this.
Yeah, Kola out of position again in the bottom side, trying to push the creep waves in an M3. Another assertive
two
Baron
smites
in the game one. Yeah, they got plenty of smites. Ulti goes in, but Condi does take the Baron. Huey going to get caught by a hook as well. Activates his ulti and gets flayed out of it instantly. Condi looks for another, does not land, but King lose the Baron in a free kill. M3 in complete control.
Kola has been the source of much of the issues. No teleport. It was spotted out by the lane wards. He must have known that there was aggressive wards on that side of the map. They'd just taken two turrets in that area, but just casually picking up jungle farm is going to be punished by Baron, a kill, and multiple turrets.
You can see Looper gets credit for that turret. 5-2 now in the turret score. Baroned up minions also contributing quite a lot to this push, and Love City fancies himself some poke. Khorne dives in for a little bit of poke damage, and Dade just pulls through the rest of the turret damage, takes the lantern while in the pool. That's a cute interaction, and King stop the onslaught for now, but M3, they're just going to keep pushing after the shopping trip.
Yeah, the minion waves are pushing, but honestly, that buys time for M3 to use the Baron buff recall, get back, build some new items. They're getting stronger and stronger. 2,500 is a gold lead in the top lane. Almost 2,500 between the AD carries as well, so multiple lanes looking good for Master 3 after a horror early learning phase, you have to remember, for SMLZ. Everything's going well for Master 3, and King have contrived to put themselves in a situation where they were going to need to be execution heavy. Well, the execution hasn't been there.
No, it hasn't. And we talked about Name's 2014 run and how good his positioning was then. He's famously said, you know, I don't need escapes or dashes. You just have to stand in the right spot. But I don't think Name had to quite deal with Hecarim, Sivir, and even Vladimir ghosting towards you, unrelenting with the Sanguine Pool. There are a lot of things for Name to worry about. We said it already. If he's the one carry for King and their other win condition is this dragon, in both situations now, they've got almost no options there.
I mean, you go back to those win conditions, Name's doing fine. He's laned very well. He's been part of a couple of kills, has your 3 out of 4 kill participation. He's hit his item timings very well. He's fallen behind in CS, but that's just because they've had no map pressure after losing the other lanes. Name's done his job. It's just, there's no point. It doesn't matter how many items Name picks up when his tank line dies instantly, when the warding can be so aggressive for flank wards from Master 3 after taking down these turrets. He's on a champion like Jinx, who, as you mentioned, doesn't have many options against the likes of a late-game top-lane Hecarim that has so much more gold income than the Hecarims of 2014. Name's doing whatever he can, but unfortunately, it's basically every other facet of King that has let him down.
Well, a Dragon up in a minute five might mean M3 even look to start taking more of those away from King as well. Khan will care what minions he can. Got a Zhonya's on the way by the looks of things. So a bit more wave clear now that he's got a big stack of AP there from the needlessly large Rob. But M3 just rotating through, using some of the Baron buff they've got left. And Nami, he'll clear waves as best he can. So will the rest of King in whatever lanes they're in. But Looper's got his teleport back up. Can pretty much join in at a moment's notice. And M3, they can do almost whatever they want from this situation.
I'm actually going to predict a Ludens will be the more likely pickup coming through from LeBlanc. Isn't going to be going for Death Cup. Doesn't really have a stack of AP to justify the purchase. Ludens for a bit more burst and wave clear. The burst is still there on Love City, but the fact that it's not killing him on a squishy support who has an Aegis mind but still doesn't have a massive stack of magic resist lets you know just how this game is going for LeBlanc, and that her target selection, even the usually squishy support, doesn't look like an 100-0 possibility for Khorne.
No, it's there in the gold lead as well, to be honest. 10,000 gold already for M3 from all the snowballing they've been doing in the last 10 minutes or so. Dragon is back up, and M3 will take it on cooldown because, again, King pretty much stuck defending their base turrets at this point.
And that's the thing. If Dragon is your main win condition and maybe team fighting, wow. Nami continues to cover himself in selfish glory, picking up a third dragon to give a whimper of hope that a 40-minute fifth dragon might be there for King. But their fighting around Dragon has let them down a bit, specifically getting caught and giving up these multiple turrets in bot. The rotations from Cola on this Gnar haven't been up to scratch either. The items keep piling in. Okay, the Dragon is a glimmer of hope for King, but it's just going to be a fast-fading glimmer, I have to assume.
Is this great to me that that's two different AD carry steals of Dragons to take them away? That one was global with the Jinx ultimate. So SMLZ, if he hadn't crit that last Dragon, King might feel a bit better about having a fourth Dragon at this stage, but I agree. It's just a lot they have to worry about here in M3. We saw yesterday that when they were ahead, they took a little bit more time than expected to close out the game, as Nami wasn't very happy after that steal, to be honest.
Well, I mean, unfortunately, stealing Dragon probably is not going to impact this game, but you often see Ezreal's, for example, launching the True Shot Barrage, trying to steal blue buffs, dragons, any manner of cooldowns. You might think, okay, how often is it actually going to come off? You have to then return to the fact that the opportunity cost is slow. Nami knows that he will have the rocket up before the next fight. He has it up already. And if you do steal away an objective, great, you get something bonus. If you don't, you're probably going to be in the same stead afterwards. The Nami fan feeling a bit empowered, but probably not so much for the King fortune.
Well, King have a lot of work to do here, unfortunately, as Dade moves into the lane as well. Level 16 now on his Vladimir with his Will of the Ancients has been completed there as well. QSS and the Last Whisper for SMLZ, Frozen Heart, Trinity for Spectre's Cal for Looper, Randu and Zomunan for Condi. Yeah, everything's going bad for King.
And the items are in position, the Baron buff's worn off, but we'll be up in a minute 30, and King haven't been on that side of the map to even hope to contest Vision in the area. It's going to take a really poor dive, or Looper just not being on the same wavelength as his teammates for them to lose a fight. The dive is a real possibility. Remember, they have good turret damage, but not a lot of range. King don't have a lot of ways to punish, though. Their initiation consists of Cola flank?
Yeah, I mean, it's Cola who needs to get in position. Maybe a Sync Dream binding with a Khorne chain for a pick, but can't really get that many picks when you're playing this defensively, and King just are getting dictated to by M3. They have to play purely reactively from this stage.
We return to what we said in Champions League. Strong lanes with a Nunu sounded like it made a lot of sense. They didn't bank on the fact that Condi would win top lane for Looper. Those problems would spill into mid lane, and Condi also made his presence known in mid lane. So actually, Hecarim and Vladimir were more than competitive against Gnar and LeBlanc. Huey tried to invade after top lane had already started to snowball for Hecarim and was just collapsed upon by Hecarim and Condi and fell himself. And now you're in this awkward late game position where if you have Nunu, low initiation, low CC lineup, and you're falling behind, your options whenever the enemy team gets aggressive is just to hope they make a mistake, and that's not much of an option at the highest tier of competitive play.
No, not quite, as Baron is back up in 20 seconds. So M3 again, I think it was three Barons in their last game won yesterday that they needed to win. I mean, I say needed. In reality, I think they were just playing very safe and finishing the game as cleanly as they possibly could. There's a bit of that going on here in this game, but M3 still, apart from that Dragon sort of getting away from them and going over to King, just feeling, again, complete control. Dada even has an Elixir. I think maybe gearing up for a team fight around this second Baron.
It's around Sieges where there's the only real area for Master 3 to make a mistake. So picking up the Baron just to make Siege that much easier. Doesn't matter if you have a 500 range AD carry when you have a Siege minion, just Siege tank just smashing down at range onto the Inhibitor turret. Taking Inhibitor is not a trivial task for this lineup. Melee champion, a Vladimir Sivir combo that does okay damage but doesn't have the range. So Baron is probably the smartest course. The first one got them a lot of advantages. The second one should secure them the win. They're being very methodical in their approach, but they even have a wonderful flank ward towards the back of the red buff. As you'll see, they cleared out a pink in that area, but not the green that had also been put down.
I think deliberate is a good way to describe how empty they've been playing in the last few days. But honestly, I think it's not to a fault. It's just very strong, very good, solid execution. And they've, you know, been much more objective focused. We noted that yesterday. I think this game as well, with a very assertive Baron call once again to get them into this position, is also the same sort of thing. So I've been impressed with M3. It might seem slow at times, but it is very calculated.
Yeah, the word yesterday around the objectives was assertive. The word today is methodical, and those are both signs of a top team. A lot of top teams are assertive and methodical. EDG, at their best, often are both those things. Sometimes they go full crazy, as we saw yesterday, but often when it counts, they are both assertive and methodical. And if Master 3 can copy that particular playbook, they're on the well way to victory.
Cole is trying to go in here. He's got the Mega now going. Dade almost gets chunked out completely. Ulti doesn't find him as he dodges it with the pull. They're kiting back. Looper dives in. Khorne forced to use his Zhonya's Cola, fighting the backline as best he can. They actually might be able to turn it around, but Looper far too strong. Sivir gets a double and 3-for-1. Dade does die, but that's the only casualty for M3.
It was a huge double Gnar from Cola, but that's just the reality of how this fight was going. As the Gnar CC was going through, Naume was zoned away, had to respect the horse in front of his face, who is killing off Khorne. In a more close game, that would have been a one-team fight for King, but with the deficit, even Naume free-hitting for most of the fight didn't matter. So Dade was caught out to start off with a wonderful binding, chose not to use his pull during any of this duration, was only CC'd towards the end, finally uses it after the flash. The re-engage happens onto Naume. Looper has to change target. It's a wonderful double Gnar. Couple of crits come through, but not enough damage.
Naume caught out of position, though, for some reason. I think he was trying to steal Baron in the picture-in-picture, but instead just gets killed for almost no reason.
Yeah, out of context there. Was following the replay. Don't know why he was caught in between the two mid lane double turrets, but I'll just have to use your reasoning that he was going for a very optimistic Baron steal.
Hanging around there with Sync Dream, maybe not the best idea. Dragon is back as well, so not even... is going to be back in time, maybe to try and steal it with his ultimate, but 20 seconds isn't the longest death timer. Will be back in time, maybe, to challenge this Baron, but M3 have already moved in. Huey does throw a ward down and a big stack in the bottom lane, giving King at least some room in the game.
Yeah, the previous King lineup was woefully poor at side wave control. It's very good side wave control coming through from King. If they steal the Baron,
gonna go in there. Nunu does get it. Huey manages to steal the Baron, channels his ulti, but goes down. But King, they're keeping themselves in this game with a series of back-to-back steals.
They're stealing the Baron. If they can just keep Master 3 interested, those minions are going to do a lot of work in the bottom lane. M3 are going to turn their attention over to a second dragon. Again, not much of a consolation prize. King are not out of this game. It's still so much work to do, but stealing that Baron and their side wave control. Look at the top wave as well. Massive wave stack.
Naume's ulti is already there. Love City this time moves in to block it, and they will get their second dragon. Fool me once, Naume, but not again. And 13,000 gold behind, King still managed to keep themselves in the game.
Yeah, all through objective shenanigans. First very optimistic steal from Naume into another optimistic steal with the flash from Nunu onto the Baron. This is the minion wave I was talking about just a second ago. Top wave prepped well. Suddenly Khorne rotates in mid. He's only a LeBlanc, but has the Baron buff minions. M3 want to fight.
Dade getting zoned out. Popped his ghost already. Looper going off there. The Sivir ult's popped as well. Huey is back around, but Sync Dream might be the next target. Snowball comes in. Cola building up rage. He wants to go aggressive. Fancies himself an initiation. Is he going to dive in? Does go into Meganar. Wallops onto Looper, but has to back away, and King needs to kite it out. M3, all they have to do is wait out the rage bar.
And King want to keep them interested, because you can see on your mini-map those minion waves continue to push well for King. I didn't think minion wave control would be a factor. It should have been just basically a free Baron for Master 3, but they didn't ward smartly around the back. They went for what was going to be not even a 50-50. You have to think it's a 66-33, given they have two smites themselves. So definitely some shenanigans. They're missing out on that Baron. The Siege continues to mid. Only the Siege minion really able to do damage.
Yeah, Khorne coming in. Good poke onto Dade, actually does decent damage. Does pay for it, though. Takes quite a lot from Dade's Qs there as well. And the Siege minion finally getting felled by SMLZ means that King still don't have this outer mid lane turret. Might be a little too much to try and pick it up at this stage.
LeBlanc had time to home guard back to the engage. Very, very low with this full minion wave. and Naomi walking in far more aggressively. They'll get at least the mid lane turret, finally breaking the outer ring.
I mean, they need some space, and that's good space move there. Dade forced to pull there. Naomi uses his ulti. Great timing! Picks up Dade, and King still on the warpath.
Dade had flash, wasn't able to use it. Used the pull, but it was the same interaction with the spell shield splash damage applying on. They're going to keep pushing.
Yeah, they are going in there. Naomi, some good timing, and they keep pushing. Jinx, so good at snowballing turrets when you have a man advantage, and this inhib is going down. King are the first team to break the base, and in fact, they've caught Condi. They're going in. He's ignited Huey. Little too deep. They're not going to get the first kill. They'll get in and get a reset, but SMLZ starting to go down in there as well. They take the inhib. King get away. Huey the only casualty, and King still 10,000 gold behind, stay in the game.
It is insane that a team that was around 13,000 to 14,000 gold behind is the first team to break the base. Master 3 were playing methodical. Sometimes if you're going to play that methodical style, the chaos that was caused by the flash Baron steal from King and the minion where they prepped earlier has got them back in this game, and they're still looking on even footing, 10,000 gold behind.
And some strong late game shot calling by King is keeping them here. They did, I think, maybe in some instances need to get a bit lucky and maneuver to this spot, but every opportunity they've been gifted back, they've used wonderfully. And scary to think of a team that's behind can play this well, because I don't know what they look like when ahead.
Well, that's why I was talking about the fact, as they stole Baron, that if they stole Baron, having that minion wave prepped as well meant they would have two factors. They'd have something that Master 3 couldn't react to, and they'd have the real big buff to deny Master 3 their easy or inevitable inhibitor and probably eventual Nexus taking. It required, again, a crapshoot to actually pick up the buff. But if you prep those ways, if you give yourself the best chance that if that very unlikely factor comes through, you set yourself up to actually win if you get that big what if.
It's the old adage in gaming, always play to win, don't play to not lose here. And that's what King have done in this game. To be fair, still have a lot of work to do here in this game. Naomi, four items now. Khan moving up to four himself. Cole getting much tankier, but M3 still with a big gold advantage translating into nice big items. SMLZ is fully stacked. Dade moving towards, I think, a much needed Zhonya's at this stage.
And honestly, at this point, now that you have four AD items onto Naomi, you need Cole and Huey to get gold to become strong. They need to be an unkillable front line. The Frozen Mallet not going to do a lot of work in that regard, just the flat health coming through. Randoran's Banshee and now a Chain Vest. That's the start of a very tanky Cola. If they can maybe delay the next fight till Cola has his Thornmail, which you have to imagine is going to be the eventual pickup for this Chain Vest, maybe that will finally be enough time and space for Naomi to put his four items and now a QSS to use to carry his team.
Could QSS there as well, only just noticed that. So King don't even have to fight for this next dragon. That's the nice thing. They can give it up if they want. Maybe even just trade for Baron Vision, which will be back in a minute 55. Big, big, tense game now that we've built up as Khan moves up to clear the minion waves in the top side. Looper in the bottom, trying to get some push going, but King, they've been on top of these side waves.
King have been on top of the side waves, being prepped by Looper as much as possible to answer that. You can see Khan looks like he wants to be organizing a slow push in the top lane. We're just waiting to see what will happen. He's leaving a couple minutes. He left one minion alive. No, he's just going to go for the gold, I guess, in this particular case. Maybe very close to his death cap, which would then give him the burst on both minion waves and champions that he was looking for. Always had the single target damage because he picked up the void staff second. Going to be going for the big AP stack. They're trying to control as much vision around dragon. At the moment, it's purely Master 3 control, barring one stray ward from King.
Yeah, M3 will take the blue buff as a result of all that vision as well, and Dragon back in 35 seconds. King, though, might just push down the mid lane and challenge them to fight. It's a little bit risky, but King seems to fancy themselves in a 5v5.
Master 3 still have 10k gold lead. Baron buff has worn out, so they are ahead in terms of items. Only Jinx can be the carry for this team. So here's Tanami trying to do it for his team.
Cole is in Meganar form as well. Dade may be caught again. Good Lantern will keep him safe, but King just going to move in immediately back away, knowing that they're out of position, and very smart retreat there from King.
The King tried to force the reaction from Master 3, then realized that they didn't have any vision towards the red or blue side jungles of Master 3, so that there was a very good inevitable chance of Looper getting onto the backline with that Hecarim. Even without teleport, if you've got no extra vision, can cover a lot of distance very quickly. He's still in position for a flank.
Yeah, they're going in there. Someone has actually already popped his ulti. Flash Flay there from Love City. Box goes down. Looper eats a Chomper. Can't go back in. Sync Dream moving through, but Cola needs to build up a bit more rage, and King disengage once more.
Smart disengage coming through from King. Everything rides on the next team fight. They're going to have to stay around this mid lane area. clear these super minion waves. No one's really interested in Dragon or Baron at this time. Looking at the top lane, it's a very familiar saying, King side wave, looking good.
Yeah, great stuff there. Bottom lane, I think in M3's favor though, so a bit of a back and forth there as Looper. Bit risky actually on top of the Dragon, but King, they want Baron here.
There's no vision whatsoever onto Looper, so it's probably a safe start unless this gives too much control to M3. Condi's caught.
Yeah, gonna get tethered there. Lantern just keeps him safe as Cola almost in Mega Enough form wants to dive in. Teleport is done for Looper as well. He takes away the Dragon, but King, they're on top of the Baron. It will be a 50-50 because there's only a smite each, but they back off, they want to go in, but M3 are not letting them.
M3 don't have any vision in the area, but are not punished with a quick Baron take. It's only Name that does really relevant damage to Baron. Cola doing a decent support act, but doesn't have any damage items to really amplify the hyper base damages. Cola's going to get, Condi's going to get poked.
Sick ward bait there under Condi, gets poked away, but fairly tanky with the Cinderhawk Glee Sin's not too bad, and there are massive waves in top and bottom that have built up. King going to take a tower, but it looks like the same might be true for M3 and King relinquish control of the Baron pit.
Who is going to be the first to react? As you mentioned, it looks like King are going to full channel their recalls. Jinx is gone. Nara is the last one around the area. M3 do not feel confident enough to do the Baron with the scuttle crab vision being on the side of King. So King are going to organize their bottom lane. Flash available on Cola. Still waiting for Cola to have the big teleport with potentially home guard and or a full rage bar. We have not seen that once in a 44-minute game.
No, we haven't. I mean, he had that decent engage when Dada kind of put himself out of position. But apart from that, it's just been some strong picks and good reactive play from King. Proactivity has not been their strength this game. It's part of the reason they're still so far behind in gold. But if they find the right openings, they've shown they can capitalize. And Name, very cute, going to clear some wards out of the back with rockets.
And again, we should probably be fair and say proactivity, we mentioned it before, not much of an option for King. Only really Cola that can go for an amazing flank initiate with the Mega Gnar. They don't have other tools to initiate a fight. Some pick potential from Morgana and LeBlanc certainly, but no AoE CC or massive initiation potential like what Looper can pull off with the Onslaught of Shadows.
And look, in some ways that maybe is just King's drafting, because that is their fault. These are the champions they picked. It's not like you get random champions when you come into a game. They drafted these five particular ones, so Dada is going to get caught, forced to pull actually as Khorne's found some creative spots. And Cola wants to go in. Khorne may be in trouble as he does find Condi. Forced to flash away there. Hook's going to land. No, just missing. But Name moves the ulti in there as Condi goes back in. Khorne trying to get some work done. Name gets dove on by Looper. Cola though, CCing Dada and Looper going to just get shredded down by the Jinx. Damage comes in. Name flashes forward. Wants to kill. Gets it onto Lovecity. Gets excited and moves forward once again. He wants to kill the backline so bad. But Looper still alive there. Has to keep cutting. Name going back in. Does go down to SM. LZ and M3 navigated wonderfully. Name, he could smell the wind, but he pays for it.
Looper is so damn tanky. Frozen Heart and a Guardian Angel. All those auto attacks for naught because you weren't ever going to get excited through the Guardian Angel proc. That's the difference between SMLZ and Name. Name had to do it all himself. SMLZ just pops the ultimate and his teammates do most of the work.
Well, we've seen this story before, but Dada is actually scouting for Huey now as well, and Nunu decides that it's not worth his life this time around. M3 will get the third Baron of this game, and it's a long one now at this stage. 46 minutes in and still no clear winner, although M3 look to be about to close the game, potentially.
And Name going to be one of the most frustrated people in the world at this League of Tanks. Hecarim, Lee Sin, Vladimir, Thresh, all super tanky. Got one reset that got him good positioning. There was just never going to be another one with Hecarim on top of him and nobody able to take him down. 8 seconds left for Khorne. No semblance of wave clear available for King, but still a bit of an overreach to try and finish the game. Yep. For Master 3.
Dada a little too low. Condi, kind of a similar story. So they'll back off. They'll try and take whatever else they can. Good minding waves prepped though by M3. Boom. As Khorne just demolishes that one in the top lane. King again, back to the same situation. Name's fully built here, even as an upgraded trinket there as well. Three dragons apiece as well means that maybe that's the next spot we look to as far as 5 points go, and waves just being traded back and forth. King, though, seem to be back on the defensive, once again trapped in their base.
King cannot fight without Name's flash. It's just not a possibility. There's not going to be a scenario this late in the game where Master 3 will one man invade into an area that isn't warded and get picked by LeBlanc and allow Name to get that first reset of the get excited. Very much need Name to have the flash available, but that's what, 2.5 minutes away from coming off cooldown. Doesn't have any boots upgrade at the moment. Still probably going to be home guards when he actually gets the option. Master Three just needs to run at Jinx, and one of their members should get on top of her and kill her.
And we've already noted it's just threat after threat after threat. Even SMLZ with the spell shield can do decent work, and there's plenty of damage and lifesteal to stay alive. You saw that last fight, Name almost desperately flash forward to try and get the kill, because that probably would have been the team fight win, but didn't have enough damage, is now fully stacked. Maybe that play works again, but King, again, gonna have to let M3 just do whatever they want at this stage. Dragon, maybe they can contest for it, but they gotta think about it soon. It's back up in a minute five.
And maybe the double Cinderhulk meta is the one of the reasons why Jinx is starting to fall out of favor. It was during the IWCI that we cast Pagetown that we know that Udyr, a very strong pick against Jinx, because can run up to her, stun her, and just be so damn tanky between health stacking and the turtle shield that the reset of the get excited or just the passive proc coming through never happened. Name got one get excited, but could never get a second or a third one to navigate all these tanky members just because there's 4,000 health trivially on multiple members of Master 3.
They couldn't get excited enough as Name flash still waiting on it. Khan don't even some poke before now, goes back and refills his health bar, but Looper just aggressively sitting on their flank, daring them to fight him.
He does not care about anything.
No, he doesn't. Kola, though, might dive straight in, wants to look for an ulti, does not find it yet. Good ulti there for Huey. Name trying to kite back as best he can, but everyone is so tanky. Kondi getting somewhat low, but now Dade is going to be the next wave that charges in, and they can't kill anyone at this stage. Syncdream going to go down as well. That's three kills already in M3. Finally, I think they've won the game.
No one is tanky when Dade throws on the Hemo Plague. All the percentage bonus damage in the late game is completely unassailable. Name stays alive, but nothing whatsoever he can do. He did his most, Huey did as well. This duo is what kept King in the game, but it will eventually be Master 3's win.
Yeah, Name still carting into his fountain at the end of the game, but then Nexus explodes in King, their third straight loss in their first 2 days, and M3, little bit shaky on the endgame execution there. I think it's not just a careful thing anymore, maybe a little careless as well.
It was chaos, though, in a lot of ways. When we're talking about a Flash Baron steal and a very optimistic Rocket steal of objectives really being the only undoing of a Master 3 methodical performance, and you can see how frustrated Name is. With his champion, he could do a lot of carrying, but in the late game, the team fights, Hecarim and friends were just too strong and too tanky for Name to ever get the reset. Needed some help from someone. And Kola in particular, I think, had quite an underwhelming game here. We never remarked on a teleport flank. He was out of position for two of the big objective plays in the early game. And the NAR pick in general just didn't really grant this team anything.
And again, Name is a player that's used to, you know, 1v5 carrying with a late game carry. But if this meta isn't healthy for him as far as that playstyle goes, then if they're a team built around Name, they're going to start struggling in this season.
You're looking for late game damage. Don't get much more than Jinx. Vayne wouldn't have made any difference in that series as well. You need multiple threats, and they didn't have that time for King.
Well, not yet. Almost found a win at the end, but M3 closed it out in a very long game. But don't go too far away. When we return from our break, we'll be back with the second game between M3 and King.